Hi everyone, welcome back to my videos on discrete-time Markov chain. So I'm going to, for this video, to continue with the theory, and we'll go back to examples after. So more precisely, I'm going to talk about recurrence and transience. So recurrence and transience, like irreducibility, are very important concepts of discrete-time Markov chain because they are going to tell us something about the limiting behavior of discrete-time Markov chains. So in short, even if things are a little bit more complicated than that, but in short, irreducibility is this concept that will ensure uniqueness of the limiting behavior of the process, while recurrence, or in fact something slightly stronger than recurrence that we call positive recurrence, is something that will guarantee existence of the stationary distortion. So more precisely, here is the plan I'm going to follow. So first, we are going to talk about the time of kth return and the corresponding probability. Then from that, I'll be able to give a rigorous definition of recurrence and transience. Then I'm going to tell you about the relationship between recurrence and transience with the expected number of visits, which is going to give us a characterization of recurrence and transience. Then using this characterization, we can prove several things. So we will be able to prove in practice in some examples, and I'm thinking of symmetric random walk. We can use that in practice to check if some discrete-time Markov chain are recurrent or transient, but something more theoretical also we can prove is that recurrence and transience are class properties. So that's the next thing I'm going to talk about. And finally, I'll show you some kind of relationship between recurrence, transience on one side and communication classes on the other side. And I give you some condition under which we can tell if communication classes are recurrent or transient. So first, let's talk about time of kth return. So basically, this means that's going to be the kth time after time zero, the Markov chain is going to visit a given state. So let's call it y. So the way we define this is recursively. So first we define, or maybe I should write first that what we are defining exactly, it's the time of kth return. To some state, let's say y. So you first define ty0 to be just zero, that's our starting time, and then we are going to define in general ty k plus 1 to be equal to the first time, so infimum of n, the first time strictly before time tyk, strictly after, sorry, time tyk, at which the process is in state y. Okay? So if you look at the time ty1, this means exactly, so the first time strictly positive at which we visit state y, and then ty2, it's going to be the first time after that time, ty1, at which we visit again state y and so on. So that's indeed, like the name says, the time of the kth return to state y. Then from that we can deduce some, we can define some probabilities that are important to define the notion of recurrence and transience. So now another definition, we define those probabilities rho x y in general. That's going to be the probability of ever going to state y, given that you start from state x. So that's exactly the probability that, so ever returning to state y means that ty1, and I'm going to write from now on, ty1 is going to be just ty, because that's the return time we are going to use the most. So it's going to be ty less than infinity. So that means exactly that indeed the first time at which we return to state Y is finite, so indeed this happens, given that we start from state X, so given X0 equals X. Okay, so we define those probabilities. So just to explain the terminology of return time, if X and Y are different, in fact the time TY at which you return to Y is in fact the something that we call the heating time. It's basically the first time at which you are going to visit state Y. But in fact, what we are going to look at after, it's the particular case where X and Y are equal. And then indeed, if X and Y are equal, this means that we start, let's say, from state X, and then we look at the probability that we'll ever return to state X again in a finite time, okay? So that's why we call both things time of case return, and we look at both conditional probabilities. So now from this, I can easily define the notion of recurrence and transience. And so those two notions are opposite of each other. So recurrent means not transient, and transient means not recurrent. So we say that state, let's say X, is recurrent if, so this means that starting from state X, the probability of ever returning to state X is going to be finite, okay? So this means exactly rho xx equals 1. With probability 1, you return to state X. So if rho xx equals 1, at the opposite, the state is transient if rho xx is strictly less than 1, meaning that there is a positive probability that if you start from state X, you are never going to come back to state X. Okay? So that's the definition of recurrence and transience. So now just one observation about those definitions is that it seems that, I mean, in our mind, recurrence means something that happens often or that keeps happening forever, while transient is something that happens only a few times. And indeed, this is what the definition means, and it's not completely obvious, but in fact, it follows from the definition, and also the fact that indeed we have a Markov chain. If you don't have a Markov chain, that doesn't work that way. But the fact that we have a Markov chain implies that indeed, if rho xx is 1, then this means that you are going to return to state x infinitely often. Okay, at the opposite, if your state is transient and so rho xx is less than 1, then that means that with positive probability, each time you visit state x, there is a positive probability that it's the last time you visit state x. And so indeed, if x is transient, this means that x is going to be visited only a finite number of times. So to see that indeed this is true, the idea is just to do the following. So we are going to look at, more generally, the time of the probability of visiting the Markov chain k times, I mean visiting state x k times if we start from state x. And then if you look at this, so this quantity is going to be the probability that, let's say, t x k is finite, given that we start from state x, okay? So this is exactly the probability of visiting state x k times, at least k times after, I mean, given that we start from state x, okay? That's the kth time of return to x. If this time is finite, that means that we are going to indeed be return to state x k times. Now, it turns out that so to compute this, you can condition on whether txk minus 1 is finite or not. And I'm just going to write that this is equal to the probability that txk is finite, given that txk minus 1 is finite, times the probability of this event, txk minus 1 finite given that we start from state x. Okay, and we can stop here because the probability, so to really have our partition, okay, we condition on the partition here, to really have our partition, we would also need to look at the probability that txk is finite given that txk minus 1 is infinite and so on. But the thing is that clearly if the time it takes to return to xk minus 1 time is infinite, which means you don't return to state xk minus 1 times, then this time should also be infinite. If you go back to the definition, you see that this time is defined as the first time after this time at which something happens. So if this is infinite, then this one should be infinite, and this conditional probability is equal to 0. That's why we can ignore the second part. And then here is the little trick. So because the process is a Markov, is a Markov process, so given that txk minus 1 is finite, you can kind of restart the process at this time. So it is finite, you wait until this time. At this time, you kind of think of this time as the initial state of the Markov chain, and you can restart everything and forget about the past. And then given this event, the probability that you will return once more to state x is exactly rho xx, okay? Here, what I'm using, I'm just saying that I'm using the fact that the process is Markov. In fact, I'm using something slightly stronger than that, called the strong Markov property. And the strong Markov property, well, tells you the same thing as the Markov property, the fact that you can forget about the past, but not starting from a fixed time, but starting from a random time. And in this case, we need a stopping time. And so I can define, I mean, it doesn't really matter what's the definition in this context, but it turns out that indeed by the strong Markov property, we can just replace this by the probability that Tx is finite, given that we start from state x. So, which means that this first conditional probability is just equal to rho xx. And then we still have this piece here, times the probability that txk minus 1 is finite, given x0 is equal to x. And then you see that we end up with, the same expression as what we started with, except that now instead of k we have k minus 1, and then by induction you can easily prove that that this quantity is in fact equal to rho xx at the power k. So this is rho xx at the power k. So what this tells you is that if rho xx is equal to 1, so if x is recurrent, then this conditional probability here is always equal to 1. So this means that if you start from state x, the probability of visiting returning to x k times is equal to 1 for all k. So meaning you are going to return to state x infinity of 1. Then at the opposite, if your state is transient, then this quantity not only is less than 1, but it's going to go to 0 exponentially fast, okay? And so this kind of suggests, okay, this power k here suggests that, tells you basically that the number of times, given that you start from state x, the number of times you return to x is basically geometrically distributed. The success parameter is equal to 0 when you have some state which is recurrent, so meaning that you never succeed in kind of escaping, and so you return to x always. But at the opposite, when your state is transient, then you obtain that this random variable has a, or not this one, but the first k such that this is infinite, is kind of geometrically distributed, with a positive success probability. So, in summary, the number of visits in state x is infinite if x is recurrent, but it behaves like a geometric random variable with a positive success probability if x is transient. And so from that, and I can maybe rewrite this first, so from that you can deduce some nice characterization of recurrence and transience. So we are going to have something slightly stronger than saying that that the number of visits in state x is infinite if x is recurrent, or finite if x is transient. We are going to look at expected number of visits instead, and then what you can deduce from that is that the expected number of visits in state x starting from x is infinite in the recurrent case, but finite in the transient case, and that's something important we are going to use soon. So then just I'm going to call that a note that kind of follows from this one here. It's the fact that x is recurrent if and only if. So the expected number of visits in state x, so I'm going to write number of visits, in state x, given that we start from state x, so this is equal to infinity. So the fact that x recurrent implies that this expectation is infinite, that's kind of obvious, okay? But then you also have the converse. So and so meaning that if your state is transient, then this expected value is going to be finite, okay? So why is it a little bit stronger than saying that the number of visits in state x is finite? Well, it's because finite random variables can have an infinite expected value, okay? So for the transient case, that's slightly stronger. To say that x is transient doesn't only mean that the number of visits in state x starting from state x is finite. This means something slightly stronger, which is the fact that the expected number of visits is finite. So then from this observation, we can prove some nice characterization of recurrence and transience. I'm going to call that theorem, which basically tells you that, gives you a relationship between recurrence, transience on one side and those n-step transition probabilities on the other side. So the theorem says that x is recurrent if and only if this infinite sum, so for n equals 0 to infinity of the Pn xx, is equal to infinity. Okay? So this is something useful in practice. So we'll see that there are cases where you don't really need to use this to deduce whether a Markov chain is recurrent or transient. But there are cases, and especially when the state space is infinite, where you really, I mean, you kind of need to have some estimate of this infinite sum. And we'll basically apply that in the next videos. We'll use this theorem to check whether the one-dimensional, two-dimensional, or higher-dimensional random walks are recurrent or transient. So how do we prove this result? Well, based on the note we have here, it seems that the only thing we need to prove is that, and it turns out that it's true, what we need to prove is that this infinite sum is exactly equal to indeed the expected number of visits in state x, okay? So that's what we want. And so proof. So if you write exactly what we mean by number of visits in state x, So this quantity here, I'm not going to rewrite this whole thing, but so it's exactly, so expected value, I'm going to write a little x here to save space, to say that it's the expected value given that we start from state x. So now we need to write the number of visits in state x, not in English, but in math. So we need some expression. And so clearly the number of visits in x is going to be the infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of the indicator function of the event that xn equals x. So what did I do here? Well, this indicator function is basically a random variable again, because xn is a random variable, so that's the random variable that is equal to 0 or 1, depending on whether xn is in state x or not. So this infinite sum is basically an infinite sum of zeros and ones, where you have a zero each time the Markov chain is not in state x, and a one each time it's in state x. So you indeed count the total number of visits by looking at this quantity. And so now what we can do is just say that this is equal to the infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of the expected value starting from state x of this indicator function of xn equals x. Okay, and then if you look at this quantity here, the expected value of indicator function is exactly the probability of this event, so that's going to be the probability that xn equals x, given that you start from state x. So we get again this infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of probability that xn equals x, given that x0 equals x. But then you see that this one is exactly the probability of going from x to x in n time step, and so this is exactly equal to that. Okay, those two quantities here are equal by definition, okay, by definition of the n step transition probabilities. So that completes the proof. Okay, that completes the proof. We were able to show that the expected number of visits here in state x is indeed equal to this quantity, but we knew already that this expected number of visits is infinite if and only if x is recurrent. So that completes the proof. Before I move forward, I'm going to use another color to insist on one thing. So I try to trick you into proof by not justifying something which is like a big thing. In fact, it's not completely obvious. It's here I just wrote that the expected value of the sum is equal to the sum of the expected values. That's clearly true if the sum is finite by linearity of the expected value, but now you have an infinite sum. So it's not clear that you can do that. And in fact, the reason why you can indeed exchange the expected value and this infinite sum, it's basically a consequence of the monotone convergence theorem, okay? So the idea, just to, I'm not going to write anything, but just comment a little bit. So you can look at this infinite sum as the limit of the partial sums. And so you can think of this infinite sum as a limit of a sequence of random variables. But the sequence of the partial sums, because those random variables are equal to 0 or 1, the sequence of partial sum is non-decreasing, okay? So you can write this infinite sum as the limit of a non-decreasing sequence of random variables, and so that's why that's by this monotonicity that you can indeed use the monotone convergence theorem, and that's why indeed the expected value of the infinite sum is equal to the infinite sum of the expected value, okay? So we have, we are done with characterization of recurrence and transience that, again, we are going to use to study symmetric random walk. This can be used in other contexts, of course, but the main application of that is symmetric random walks. Now, I'm going to use that again to prove some other important theorem, which states basically that recurrence and transience are class properties. So I'm going to explain what we mean by that. So now I'm going to remind you this theorem that I just erased that we need here. So theorem, X is recurrent if and only if the infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of Pn xx is equal to infinity. And now from that we can deduce another theorem saying that recurrence and transience are class properties. So what does it mean that a property is a class property? So class refers to communication classes. So this means that all the states in the same communication class should all have this property, should all share the same property. And so in this case, this means that if two states communicate, let's call them X and Y, then X and Y should both be recurrent or they should both be transient. You cannot have one state recurrent, one state transient in case they communicate. So this is what we mean by class property. And so the proof of that, it's basically an application of this previous theorem that we proved. So let's assume that X and Y communicate. So I'm going to just write X communicate with Y. And I'm going to assume also that X is recurrent. I'm sorry. X is recurrent. Okay, and then the goal is to prove that in this situation, then Y should be recurrent. Then we don't really need to prove that if X is transient, Y is transient, because this relationship is symmetric, we saw that. And we know also that being transient means not recurrent. And so it's just enough, like from a logical point of view, it's just enough to prove this. So, if we assume that X and Y communicate, so this means that there exists Nn such that Pn xy is strictly positive, but also Pn yx is strictly positive. Okay? And then what we know also from this characterization of transients, we know also that the infinite sum of the pkxx is infinite, okay, because x is recurrent. I'm using k instead of n, because we already used n here, n is fixed. And so we also know that the infinite sum of the pkxx is infinite. And what we want to prove that y is recurrent, is again use this characterization and prove that the infinite sum of the pkyy is infinite. So how do we do this? We are going to once more use Chapman Kolmogorov equations, but this time we are going to split our path into three subpaths instead of two. And so you can basically write that the infinite sum for k equals 0 to infinity of pk y y, and I'm going to split that by saying maybe I can draw a little picture here. So if you want to go from y to y, basically what you can do is go from y to x. So this is y, this is x. You go from y to x, then after you can go from x to x, and we know that each time you are in state x, you are going to return to state x because x is recurrent, and then you want to go from x to y. So now it turns out that the probability of going from y to x or from x to y is positive in finite number of steps. That's because the two states communicate. The fact that each time you visit x, you return to x, it's true also because x is recurrent, and I'm going to use this basically this partition of a path, you can go from y to y itself by going from y to x, then x to x, then x to y. And then what this thing becomes here, it's basically, so the point is that I cannot start at zero, I need to have at least n plus m steps. So we can just write that this is equal to the sum, or it's larger in fact. It's larger than the sum for k equals 0 to infinity of p n plus k plus m y. Okay, so why is it true? So when I do that in class, typically my students don't understand this inequality, saying that when y is pk yy larger than this quantity, it's not clear. Well, in fact, it's not true. But if you look at the two sums, basically, the two sums are the same, except that this one starts from k equals 0, while here it's the same sum as here, but starting from n plus n instead. Okay? And so that's why the two sums are the same, except that this one is missing the first n plus m terms. And then after using Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, you can prove that again this is larger than the sum for k equals 0 to infinity of so I want to use those, so it's going to be pm yx, then pk xx, then pn xy. Okay, so this inequality basically tells you that to go from y to y, the probability of going from y to y in n plus k plus m steps should be larger than a particular subset of path that consists in going from y to x first in m steps, then from x you return to x k steps times steps after, and then from x you go back to y in m steps. So basically it's really like the reason why you have an inequality here is really the fact that here we look at the probability of an event, while here we look at the probability of a sub-event, okay? So that's why this is true, but then you see that by assumption, okay, x and y communicate, so this quantity and this one are both strictly positive. You can put them also outside the sum because the sum is only over k. So eventually you obtain that this infinite sum is equal to a positive number which is fixed times the infinite sum over k of pk xx, which we know should be infinite because x is recurrent and this sum here is infinite. So eventually you get that this is infinite. And then this tells you that indeed the infinite sum of the pky is infinite, so y is recurrent. And so that completes the proof. So again, now if you assume now by symmetry of this relationship, that means also that if y is recurrent, then x should be recurrent. And then you obtain that if x and y communicate, x is recurrent if and only if y is recurrent. And because transient means not recurrent, you end up with also that x is transient if and only if y is transient. So that also shows that transience is also a class property. Okay? So that completes this lecture. I should maybe mention one last thing. So now what we want to do is to put together this notion of transience recurrence together with the notion of communication classes. So now that we know that that recurrence and transience are class properly, so what this means is that if these are your communication classes and you look at two states here, then again they both should be recurrent, both should be transient, so that means that across the same communication class all the states are all recurrent or all transient. In fact, you don't need to use the previous characterization I gave about recurrence or transience to know if there are recurrence or transience or in some specific cases. So there are three cases. Two of them are easy, one is more difficult. So first case, assume, so let's call that C, that's one of the communication class. So assume that C is closed and finite. So if your class is closed and finite, clearly because it's closed, once you start from this class, you have to stay in this class. And because it's finite, at least one of the states in C should be visited infinitely often. Okay? You cannot spend an infinite amount of time on a finite set without visiting at least one element infinitely often. So this means basically that at least one state is visited infinitely often. This state should be recurrent. And because this state is recurrent, then, and by the previous theorem we proved, recurrence is a class property. This means that any communication class that is closed and finite should be recurrent. Okay? So in this case, you have recurrence. So notice that now I'm not saying a state is recurrent, I'm completely saying that a class is recurrent, which I can do because we indeed proved that recurrence is a class property. So second case, what happens when C is not closed? Well, in this case, this means that you can find X and Y, X in your communication class C and Y outside, such that the probability of going from X to Y is positive. Okay, that's a property, that's the definition of not being closed. And so in this case, it's clear that X cannot be recurrent. Okay, X has to be transient. So Y, well, if you start from state X, there is a positive probability PXY that the Markov chain jumps from X to Y, but we saw last time that if you exit a communication class, if you leave a communication class, you cannot come back. So this means that there is indeed a positive probability that if you start from state X, you never return to state X. That's exactly the definition of transient. So we deduce from that X must be transient, and again, because transient is a class property, all the states in C should be transient. So in this case, you have transient. And then the third case, which is much more complicated, the third case tells you that if C is none of those two cases, so that would mean closed but infinite. If C is closed but and infinite, and basically, we are going to look at that in the case of irreducible Markov chain, where basically your whole class is equal to the state space. So if you have an irreducible Markov chain with infinite state space, then in this case, it's not clear whether the process is recurrent or transient. You are in none of those two simple cases, and that's where you need to compute the infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of the Pn xx. So by computing, I just mean you need to have a good enough estimate of Pn xx to be able to tell whether this infinite sum is finite or not. That's enough, you don't need to compute the explicit value. And from that, you can deduce whether your class or your Markov chain itself, if you have an irreducible Markov chain, is going to be recurrent or transient. So this is the difficult case, and in the next few lectures, I'm going to apply that. In particular to the symmetric random walk in one and two dimensions. And that's it for today.